That's not one.
Okay.
Okay, ready, are you ready?
Yes, I'm.
You had a practice run or anything?
I think so.
I practiced.
Yeah, practice real run.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you everyone for coming to June's defense. Thanks very much. I'm sure it's a happy day for June. I just thought I'd open with a story. Before June started his PhD, he had an offer to go to work with Jen Rexford at Princeton to do his PhD. I convinced him to stay here and then I left him. This time I guess he has an offer from Jen Rexford again to do Russ Clarke kinds of things at Princeton. She's going to be IT group there. So this time he actually took it. So so we have June's defense today. Alan and I are on the committee. Mustafa and Nate Foster from Cornell are also on the committee, although neither of them could make it. This is like the most distributed defense ever.
Yeah.
So June did a, he's half defended as of Wednesday.
You can wear the cap, but not the gown.
And on the phone, we have Yoshio Turner, who June did a lot of work with at HP. And I think he's going to talk about some of that today. Some really, really cool stuff. And Yoshio's also moved on to great things at a startup without Banyan. So without further ado, please.
Okay. So hello, everyone. My name is Jun Kim. And today, I will defend my thesis work titled Facilitating Dynamics and Animal Control with Software-Defined Networks.
Yeah.
So the high-level research questions I focus on my dissertations are.
Maybe it's a battery.
What's that? So I'll just say it. Why is network compute so hard? And what would be a better way to do it? And in my proposal work, I have presented a work on analyzing over 5 years of compute files from two large networks, which were Georgia Tech and University of Wisconsin. And through our studies, we have learned how networks are configured today and how configuration files evolve over time. We also learned that configuration is very hard, and there are several causes for this. First is, high-level tasks are realized through low-level commands and scripts, so it's hard to understand. Second, all the configuration files are distributed all over the network, so it's hard to manage. Third is the variety of network-wide tasks cause changes to the network, so there are a lot of dynamics in the network. But regardless of so many changes, no changes are actually checked for correctness. So mostly the changes are error prone. To confirm our findings, we did a separate survey with over 200 network operators. And 20% of them said they make changes more than once a day. 89% say that they were never completely certain that the changes will not introduce a new bug. And 82% of them said they are concerned that changes they make might break existing functionalities unrelated to those changes. And whenever I present this to other operators, they say, you should track down those 10-20% operators who say they're always certain, because they're lying. So in recent years, we saw an introduction of a new way of configuring and managing network called software-defined networking. And in contrast to traditional networks where individual devices have embed their own control logic, software-defined networking advocates to have one control logic embedded in the central controller as a software program. However, SDN is not a silver bullet. So SDN does allow you to write your own program in C++, Java, or Python. So that's much better than low-level commands and scripts used in traditional networks. SDN central control scheme makes everything easier to manage compared to all the distributed configured files in the traditional networks too. However, SDN still lacks a good abstraction for capturing the dynamics in the network. And also, SCN does not have anything inherent, the feature to actually check the correctness of the changes the program can make. So these are the things my decision tries to tackle. So what SCN platform needs is a guidance on how to implement a network control program, and specifically how to provide dynamic control that handles arbitrary events, and such as intrusion detections, traffic load shifts, and link or switch failures. SCN also needs a verification and guarantees of program's correctness. And also there are some huge missed opportunities, regardless of the fact that the control logic is written as a software program. So I keep talking about network events, and but what kind of network events are I talking about? So there are a lot of different types of network events. Some events related to network traffic could be a traffic load increase and decrease, some security incidents. Some user-specific events could be user authentications, excessive data usage of the host. Data plane events could be topology changes or switch or link failures. So it's actually very interesting to see that different operators may have different reactions to a same event. For example, if the event was host is infected, some operator may say only block that infected host. The other one could say block all communications in the network, yet the other one could say only allow communication within the internal network. But there are also some events which they all have all the same reactions. Like switch or link failures, the operator will say one reaction, which is recover connectivity. In fact, for 15% of the operators we surveyed said they want reliability tasks to be automated the most. That includes the configuration of backup.
What does that mean exactly? So when you ask them about what task they would most favor having automated, can you give them a set of choices?
Yeah, we do.
And they pick reliability.
Yeah.
And how many choices do they have?
I think there are four.
So does that mean they're picking something else? But then they're picking, this is not the, so there's some other tasks that they would like to have.
Yeah, there are some
more than reliability.
Yeah, there are some verifications or some other network-related events, like verifications or things, which actually Kinetic handles. And this part is for Coronet, which is part.
And I'm not sure whether you should, I heard something. So you got disconnected. And I still think I have connectivity myself.
It always happens during the slide of that.
You planned it that way, June.
Sorry. Yeah, sure. Okay. Still here?
Yes. Yes.
Too, same time.
Yes. Yeah, go on. My internet got flaky.
Okay. Okay, cool.
You're always found on the internet.
Someone needs to work on that.
That's why we have to work on this, right? So, okay. In my thesis, I'll try to convince you that network events and dynamic reactions to them should be programmatically encoded in the network control program by operators. And for some events, the platform should transparently automate reactions to them if the desired reaction is checked. So in my thesis, I have two solutions, which are called Kinetic and Coronet. So Kinetic is a domain-specific language and control platform, which helps operators to create SCN control programs that embed these custom event and reaction relationships. And Coronet is a transparent data plane failure recovery service for STN, and it lifts the burden of building custom recovery mechanisms for each network. So in this talk, I will present Kinetic, followed by Coronet, and then I will conclude this talk by a summary of contributions, lessons learned, and future work. So to start with Kinetic, I want to start with a motivating example. The start system was a user access control system, which was deployed in the Georgia network several years ago. And I'll explain how it used to work. So the client connects to the network, and the next hop switch will ask the VLAN management policy server and see whether the network ever saw this client. And if it never saw this client, it will put on an unregistered VLAN and then port that traffic up to the registration server. So the user is responsible of registering his or her client. And if that's done, the network will update the firewall so that only the traffic between the scanner and the client is allowed. If the scanner cannot find any known vulnerabilities in the client, it'll update the firewall again so that the client can go to can reach anywhere in the network. It will also update the VMPS server so that it has the most updated information about that client. And then when the host reconnects, the NetCloud switch will ask again, and the VMPS, because it's successfully registered, it'll put on a registered VLAN, and then finally, packet can go through internet. So there are really interesting things in this example. The fact is there are a lot of network events. It's just changing the forwarding behavior in the network. The problem here is everything is done by ad hoc scripts, automated with ad hoc scripts, and the configuration and changes are distributed all over the network. It's just simply too complex. So we needed a better way. So our idea was to have a single software program that embeds all these event and reaction relationships. And this way, if the event comes in, it can make updates to the forwarding policy, and it will push rule updates to the data plane accordingly. However, there are some unanswered questions here too. Like, how are we going to actually embed this event and reaction logic in the software? And how are we going to verify the program will make changes correctly? And these are the problems Kinetic tackles directly. So our approach is first provide a domain-specific language, which the operators will use to implement their control program. The language itself is constrained but structured so that it will prevent them from making more mistakes when they actually make their program. We express the changing behavior as a finite state machine, where the state denotes a unique forwarding behavior in the network, and the network events will trigger the transition between the states. Third, we verify the program's correctness with a model checker called USMB. So first, I will present Kinetic's domain-specific language. The language itself,
A new SMB is your thing, or that's something that exists in the world and turns out to be useful for this?
It's in the world and it's supposed to be useful for this. Okay, so the language itself is embedded in Python, and it borrows some abstractions from another language called PyReady. As PyReady encodes the forwarding behavior in a policy variable, and the policy variable is responsible of transforming the incoming packet to a set of outgoing packets in the network. But unlike PyReady, Kinetic has new constructs and functions to express policies that respond to changing conditions. So unlike PyReady, it can update the policy variable dynamically by network events. So next, I will present the finite state machine abstraction used in Kinetic using an example, an intrusion detection system example. So in the IDS example, the event will be an alert called infected. And the state will be a unique policy variable's value, which could be allow or block. So at first, the initial state is where the policy is allow on the left side. And if you see an event where the infected becomes true, we'll go to the right state where the policy is to block. And later on, we can see an event where it says that the event became false. We'll come back to the left side where the policy showed up. But there's some problem here. We cannot apply this finite state machine on the whole network, because we cannot block every traffic because just one host is infected. So there are many different flows in the network, and each flow should have its own distinct finite state machine. So to solve this, Kinetic decomposes these to a number of finite state machines, multiple finite state machines. So the FSM instance is instantiated per flow. So for this example, the host will have its own finite state machine, where it can have its own variable for the policy, which is allow or block. And we just compose them together. And if we assume there are n number of hosts, the total number of states will be 2n, as well as the total number of transitions. So everything is linear in it. Next, the LPEC abstraction. So in the IDS example, flow is defined by a source IP address, which was post. But the thing is, like, different policies can use different definition of a flow. So for this, we have an abstraction called Located Packet Equivalence Class, or LPEC. And we, using this abstraction, programmers can actually define their own flow. For example, if you want to define a flow as based on the Bastion IP, you can just define a method like this, so that the flow and FFN instance will be instantiated per destination IP. So next, I'll talk about the verification process in Kinetic. So Kinetic verifies the correctness of the program using the user-specified temporal properties, and it verifies the current and future forwarding behavior based on network events. And the verification process is completely automated. This is possible because the language itself is constrained but structured. And this allows automatic parsing and translation of the program that the operator has written. And the very important thing is verification runs before the program deployment. So we can actually check the correctness of the program before we actually put it online. So the verification process is as following. The Kinetic program will automatically generate an FSM model fit for the new SMB model checker. The user can specify some temporal properties, and together with that, the model checker will return whether true or false of the temporal properties. So I want to give you some examples of these properties I'm talking about. For example, if you want to say, if a host is infected, please draw packets from that host. And we can express that using a language called CTL. This is computation tree logic, one of the language you can express temporal properties. And I'll kind of walk through this simple example. So A means for all possible transitions from the current state right now. And G means for all current and future states. If infected happened, the next A is also for all possible transitions from the current state. X means for the next state. So it means the next state, the policy should be dropped. So using this logic, you can actually express fairly complicated properties like if a host is authenticated either by web or 802.1x and is not infected, packet should never be dropped. And this can be also expressed using this language. There are some additional features of NewSMB. It returns the counter examples when the user specified temporal properties becomes false. And it returns the initial state and the sequence of events that leads to that falsification. It also has some default checks for are there any unreachable states, or is there a possibility to get stuck in one state forever. We have evaluated Kinetic in two terms. We did a usability evaluation where we did a user study against over 870 participants. And we also did some analysis on lines of code, comparison with other platforms. We measured.
How did you set up that user study?
User study.
How did you set up the user study?
So we set up the user study using the Coursera course.
Ah.
Yeah. So we had all the RB and stuff set up for that. So we also did a performance and scalability test, and we measured the event and handling and policy recompilation time, which I'll explain later. So for the user study, we had over 870 participants with varying professions and varying experience in networking. The total number differs because some questions were not required to answer. The task we gave them is to implement an enhanced IDS program with Kinetic and Pyretic and POX, which are different platforms, and then compare them. So the first question we asked was, please rank the platforms by preference, where rank one means the most preferable. And as you can see here, Kinetic is the most preferable platform when writing these dynamic control programs, followed by Pyretic and then POX.
What did you do to offset the potential for them to like Kinetic because they knew that you were
Sure. So the course actually taught kinetic, pyretic, and pox like all together.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I put more focus on pyretic pox first. They were like learned first, and the kinetic was like later for that. So we thought like pyretic will be more they would be more used to using pyretic and pox, and they're more trained for that. Actually,
did they know that you had written kinetic?
I don't know actually. I think they. We didn't actually explicitly say that.
We didn't say that. I guess.
Yeah, we didn't say that.
Okay, so you don't know.
It wasn't anonymous.
You don't know to what extent they knew that you kinetic was yours.
If they looked at the webpage or something, they would.
Yeah, we didn't say anything explicit.
It wasn't like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But if they tried to find out, they if it's possible.
Mm-hmm.
If they tried.
So it sounds like you did. You probably didn't go, and I'm not suggesting I have in mind the way you would have gone further to offset that possibility. But as you probably know, there are some. Actually, Nikki Dell, who has an offer from Interactive Computing, has a paper on essentially how, in a particular context, an ICTD context, when researchers ask people, you know, do you like my system? I mean, not exactly like that.
Yeah,
but
true.
But that there's an absolute inherent bias just to tell you that they
true.
Like your system. So.
Yeah.
Actually, since you were interrupted, I mean, can you talk about the other kinds of bias that could come up in this kind of evaluation here? I mean, some of these things came up in paper reviews and stuff. I think it's hopefully you took something away from that. What other kinds of bias? When you ask people, for example, or when even things like you count the lines of code or you ask people which one was easier of these three,
mm-hmm.
what other kinds of bias can come out
from the let's see. I mean, I guess because, yeah, I mean, in the paper it was too, like, because your system is, I think the same point as Ellen is the biggest one, I think, how did you, it could be biased towards kinetic. Some other bias could be, let's see. I guess in the course itself, we try to say kinetic is fit for dynamic control, and they just kind of feel that way. It should be fit for dynamic control. That bias could come out. Other than that, I think there's no big bias towards kinetic. I mean, it's just designed well for like handling abstractions, right? And
ordering, could there be any bias because like they did pox first and then kinetic next? I mean,
if you think about it, like either way, so we had some review, like because you presented kinetic later, they may be biased towards pyretic and towards kinetic. But I actually think the order, it could be the other way too, right? We could say like we make them learn kinetic first and get used to it more, followed by pyretic and pox. They can, because they're more used to kinetic, they can like kinetic first too. Right. I mean, it depends. So it depends how you interpret it. So the order does
so
not.
It wouldn't be not compatible with a class, with a MOOC or any classroom setting. But if you randomize the order in which they learned them, then you could get, and you had a big enough sample size, you could eliminate that.
I guess.
There are probably ways to.
Is it possible that the kind of tasks that you asked them to do during the course were more kind of geared towards things that kinetic is really good at?
Yes, that was actually the programs and the assignments we gave for Pyret and Pox were mostly like programs for like static configuration stuff, not dynamic control. And kinetic is fit for that. And I guess like let them make these programs in Python and Pox too. And of course, this is actually the goal of the study. Like, what we want to actually see whether kinetic is fit for dynamic control. I would actually assume if we make people to write programs which does not have dynamic control with kinetic, it'll be like maybe similar.
Yeah, if you stress applications where, or use cases where, you know, pyretic particularly shines, if it's like composability or something where it's really good, maybe you get a different result.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Like if something pirating in POX shines, like for example, like POX, it has more global commands and more detailed configuration. So if operates like that, actually the reason some people took POX was they actually preferred that one. But for composability, actually, Kinetic has that composability too. So that is same for Canadian pirate application. Cool. Okay. So we also did some analysis on lines of code comparison with Kinetic and Pirate and POX. The lines of code for Kinetic is around 20 to 21 lines of code, where Pirate is about 50 lines of code, and POX, you will have around 70 to 100 lines of code. We also compared Kinetic with other platforms like Pirate and POX and Floodlight. It shows that Kinetic's lines of code is comparable to Pyretic, and tends to be much shorter for compared to POX or Floodlight. Some notable quotes from the user study. We asked them, why do you prefer Kinetic? They said the best feature they liked was the finite state machine-based structure and support for intuition. They said Kinetic is more intuitive. The only thing I need to do is define the finite state machine variable. It's intuitive and easy to understand. The programming state transitions in the finite state machines makes much more sense. They also like its conciseness. Said it reduces the number of lines of code, and the logic is more concise.
Question.
Sure.
What about the negative comments?
Yeah.
Can you comment on those?
Yeah. So the negative comments is.
And where are they?
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, maybe
sure it wasn't all awesome.
Yeah, it was not all awesome. So one of the things is it has good abstractions, but one of the comments I think it's hard to debug. Because it's had a lot of abstractions, it kind of tries to prevent the bugs, but if their bug actually happens, it's hard to find it because it's hiding a lot of stuff. Those are some negative comments, I think. Another one is it has a slightly steep learning curve at first. If you get used to it, if you get hold of it, it's better, but it has some steep learning curves. So those are some negative comments I got.
It sounds like, as you describe it, it sounds very similar to it is DSL, so it makes sense, but think about other sort of strongly typed programming languages, DSLs that people design.
Yeah.
That have strong types.
Yeah, exactly.
Haskell or OCaml or something like that, their programs are always a pain in the neck to write.
Yes, exactly.
But if you get them to run, they're correct.
They're correct.
It's actually writing them.
Yeah.
So what you said kind of reminds me of that.
Yeah, this was the pros and cons, and it's really important that you get the right balance. So we also did some evaluations on event handling possible compilation. So these both metrics are very important in Kinetic because network events actually will cause Kinetic to react and recompile because it was going to update the forwarding behavior. So it's really important how Kinetic reacts to events. Right? So the x-axis shows we actually deferred the event arrival rate, events per second. The y-axis is the summation of event handling and recompile time. The solid bar is showing when we run a single Kinetic program, and the dotted one is showing when we run multiple Kinetic programs that compose to each other. And we just thought, if you compose those programs together, it's going to take more compile time, which is showing in this graph as well. But as we see, even if we have 1,000 events coming in per second, it shows that Kinetic can actually finish everything within 200 milliseconds, which seems reasonable. Okay, Kinetic has real deployments. For the campus network, we had a functional access control system, which is a re-implementation of the example I showed, the model example I showed. It was deployed in Juratek over 3 buildings. We also had a home network deployment, which we ran a user-space access control system. We deployed it in 21 SDN-enabled wireless routers over 3 continents. The user study went around to 1 year and a half, and the results was presented in ACM PIs 15, which I just came back from. Okay. Some takeaways.
What was the reception at Kai?
Huh? How's the reception?
What was the reception? Not the party part.
So there's.
I know they party a lot.
Yeah, so because it's Kai, we had some good comments about user studies mostly, I think. There was not many questions about the system itself. There were some questions about, so we kind of like do the capping on the download. What do you do for the unload? Because unload is getting bigger these days.
Mm-hmm.
That was some good comment, which we don't handle, but that one huge works right now. The other comment was, from the households, did you have families with the kids?
Mm-hmm.
And did try to use this system to do some parental control.
Mm-hmm.
So we did have some families with this, and they did use it for that purpose. Some other comment was, can you try to use this on like mobile networks?
Mm-hmm.
But our response to that is, you know, mobile networks, you have one phone, like for your phone network, and you can have, it's better to have an application on your phone itself, that's better. Because for this, it's better if you have multiple devices at home and you need to manage them all together, and you have a lot of people using it. So those are the comments I have. So some takeaways here is our extensive user study shows that Kinetic makes it much easier to express dynamics in the network. It helps to reduce the number of lines of code. It scales well to large networks and a lot of events, and the verification process reduces the bugs in the programs. Some notable publications out of this work is we had one in IEEE Commissioning Magazine. I decided, and then more recently we have given an SDI, which I will go next week.
This is a practice conference too.
Yes, this is also a practice. Okay, so next I will present Coronet, which is a transparent data plane together with microservices for SDN applications. So Kinetic is an app for custom reactions to arbitrary network events.
Do you want to see if Yoshio has any questions?
Oh, sorry. So, Yoshio, do you have any questions?
He may have trouble interrupting.
Yeah, sure. Yoshio, do you have any like other questions for Kinetic?
Yeah, so I have two, basically. So one is about interaction between different finite state machines. It seems to me that a packet could belong to one of your located packet equivalence classes, but then as it undergoes transformations in a network, like destination addresses gets changed by some NAT or something like that, then it can then belong to a different equivalence class and therefore would get a different finite state machine. Do you have to reason about interactions between different finite state machines, or is that somehow, can you somehow separate?
So that's a really good question. So for now, I think Kinetic, we had that comment, like, is there any interaction between finite state machines? Can a finite state machine instance inform another finite state machine or next one and do some interaction between them? Right now, we don't have anything like that right now. And if the first finite state machine transforms the packet and goes to the second one has its own LPEG abstraction. So right now, it doesn't handle any explicit thing about it,
but there are some. Those are one of the future works we have to think about.
Okay, so then that means sort of for the model checking part, you wouldn't be able to verify sort of end-to-end properties based on because you can't handle the reasoning across the different binary state machines.
Yeah, if it actually transformed the packet, I think. Let's see. If it transformed the packet. If it does some NATing, it's possible that we will not be able to transform. But the thing is, like that verifies in the USMB is not like packet specific. I think it's more like, is the program going to make changes correctly? So it's not like packet specific actually.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's
then,
more like if this event comes in, is the whole program is it going to like change accordingly?
It doesn't model all the packets or like all the fields there.
Okay, and then I was wondering about kind of how you get from where you are now to a practical deployment of Kinetic or widespread adoption of it. So, what do you see as the kind of missing gap there between the research you've done and getting it to a point where people could use it in production?
Yeah, so one thing is like, I think, which is not inherent in Kinetic itself, is like SDN itself has some performance issues. I think that's one of the biggest hurdles we have to go over, first of all. And I think for Kinetic itself, I think it's really important that we have give out some really good debugging tool too, because I think on the resources, we also like, if they actually screw up making a good Kinetic program and they make errors, and the thing is like in Kinetic, we didn't have some really good error messages, I think. And because of that.
That's kind of ironic, right? in that one of the things you were trying to overcome was
yeah, if
the
it actually happens.
Error,
yeah, because this is like the language
traditional
itself.
Configuration.
So the language itself is DSL. The thing is like Kinetic will actually tell you before you actually deploy it. That's one thing. But
tell you what?
Tell you actually you made an error.
I see, I see. It's just not helping you. I see.
It will fail.
It will just not let you run.
It won't help you
figure
run,
out.
It won't help you get a
yeah,
runnable
yeah.
program.
Got it.
Yeah. So that one of the gaps I think we have to feel like we have to really better got them more, actually. Right.
Which I don't know, I would probably argue I would say that it's probably better that it fails before you deploy it.
It's better
than if you, I mean, in comparison to the sort of status quo, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's much better that we actually can find, like, and prevent them actually running it, right? I think that's really important. It's one of the important things that Kinetic already has. Any other questions, Yoshi?
Sure. If you give me the opportunity, I'll ask more questions. about composability, is it? Do you foresee that it's possible for different developers or completely different administrative domains to be writing programs that then fit together in a kind of a hierarchical way?
Yeah, that was actually our initial. Goal actually to make so that other administrator operators can make their own program and then we can actually compose them together. And yeah, exactly, that's one of the things we actually want. Because that's actually happening in the real network right now. There's not one developer doing it or operator.
Do you see any technical difficulty? Or can the system you built already accommodate that?
So the system itself actually does accommodate that right now, but we'll have to actually see how it turns out, I guess. Like, it's hard to foresee what's going to happen, but as far as I know, there's no big thing which will prevent them from proposing and building their own stuff and proposing it right now.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Cool, thanks.
On your slide 30, when you did the line of code comparison,
yeah.
So there are these like five programs. I was wondering if you could say, and then there are these things that are out there. I was wondering if you could say like a little bit more about how you picked the five programs here. Were there 10 candidates, and these you slimmed down five? Did you have to like scrub around and find? Like, was it based on what was available, or what was? You think this is a good set?
Sure. So it was based on a lot of stuff. First of all, yeah, we have to find like programs which are already out there, right? We don't want to like.
So you didn't rewrite them.
We didn't rewrite them. These are like out there.
Yeah.
Because if we write them, that's biased again, right? So we picked programs out there which is available, and also some programs. Some programs and some policies we actually found it on, like for example, the user space rate limiter is a good example where operators actually use that a lot. And we actually found a lot of campuses which has this real network policy. So, and which has dynamic controlling. So we tried to find programs which has some dynamics in them and which is already also available in other languages and also based on real policies.
Just a suggestion. I mean, if you think that these five programs are like a useful benchmark, if you will, you might consider, I mean, given that your conference is like next week,
yeah.
zipping this
packaging,
up, packaging it up, and in your talk also saying, and here is basically, I mean, four different controller programs that do these things. I mean, there could be some, often these things provide way more benefit than paper ever will, sadly, maybe. But the point being, I think, the people who do this kind of work may struggle to do what you did, to come up with programs that can be compared across languages and are meaningful for network management.
Sure.
The common criticism, I mean, Mac Learner is probably not a useful network management program, but some of the others are. So someone who comes along and writes the next thing, you could even go so far as to like suggest in the talk, maybe people should be using it, if you actually believe that.
Yeah.
I don't know if you believe it or not. Do you, I mean, do you believe that, or is that a reasonable thing?
Yeah, I do believe that. It's like, I mean, it's really important also, I think therefore operators do have their own, like in Nano, they try to like discuss what kind of network policy they want, and what's are useful, and what's the good practice between them. And I also try to get some applications out of like attending those sessions. I think it's really important also, like we can, so one of the things at Kinetic and also in SDN world is like we want to actually share some programs too with other operators, and that's important. And in Nano, they try to do it by doing a session, like we do it this way, why don't you do it this way? I think it's really important that we also, I try to identify, right, rewrite the network policies which are done in traditional networks, share them, and say like, this is better to do it this way.
Yeah, I mean, you could have a real contribution here if you invest some time packaging it up.
Yeah.
I mean, it's topologies, right? Probably many more people use your topology than a red paper.
Okay. Right, but every time they use it,
they cite the paper.
They cite the paper, so.
Right, so your paper might get cited not for the kinetic, but actually for the benchmarks.
Yeah. I see. It's interesting. Yeah, so I'll definitely put some time on that.
Plus, it really takes no time. Right? So
absolutely no time.
Useful and
big
win.
Additional.
So can just go on. So I'll present Coronet, our transparent data plane data recovery service for SDN applications. So Kinetic is apt for costs and reactions to our events. But what about unplanned data plane flares like link or switch flares? Data plane flares are very common but can have serious impact. It can take down the whole data center like Amazon or other web services out there on the internet. Data plane failures are interesting because unlike other specific network events, the desired reaction is mostly identical among operators, which is the cover forwarding behavior as before. So what the operator wants is mostly the same, but how to achieve it is widely different. Even if this simple topology is the same, the recovery mechanism actually changes depending on where the failure happened. But then consider like writing a recovery mechanism for this topology. So what we say is operators should not grapple with such specific recovery mechanisms, and the network connectivity should be recovered automatically. Okay. Some may say that's easy. We can just fix the flow tables in relevant switches when the failure happens. And I will show you that's not the case. So let's say the link fails between S1 and S5 here. We can just update the bottom switch, S5, so that it uses another top switch, S2, to forward traffic. If we assume all the hosts here, 256 hosts, are communicating with each other, we will need around 3,500 flow table entries updates and all the bottom switches. More importantly, the switch with most updates will need around 1,800 updates. The thing is, like when we did a benchmark of our own on the switch, it turns out the rule update rate is about 55 moves per second. So if you apply this, it turns out the recovery time will be about 32 seconds, which is unacceptably slow. There's another problem. The operator might have her own application running on the network. And so fair question is to ask, how does coronavirus recovery service play along with my own SDN apps routing policy? Because Corona is going to fix some routing cables if it tries to cover. So there are a lot of actually challenges in this problem. You have to guarantee recovery for any topology that is given to us. You have to ensure fast recovery even in large networks, which could have over 100 switches. You have to make sure that it works together with other SDN applications. So Coronet is our answer to this. It is an SDN module that provides data plane failure recovery service to SDN applications. It works with any topology, and it recovers failure within 2 seconds at most with a network which can have 100 switches and over. And it's also composable with other SDN applications. We made some interesting design choices and approaches to make sure we handle all the challenges here. To guarantee recovery for any topology, we pre-plan the primary and backup path, and we use interesting research and techniques used in graph theory. To provide fast recovery in a scalable manner, we use some special forwarding techniques like label switching and grouping flows together for recovery. To make sure our service works together with other SDN applications, we use an abstraction called virtual topology abstraction. So first, I'll talk how we prefer the routing path. To guarantee recovery for any failure in the network, we just make multiple disjoint routing paths on topology. Or here, you can see there's a blue route tree and a red route tree, which are completely disjoint, except for the host attached switches. So if you have this, you are guaranteed that any failure in the network, you will have at least one route tree working. This simple approach is actually nothing new. In graph theory, there are a lot of great research which tries to solve the same problem and has a very similar spirit as our approach. So we use these techniques and we reference them and we use them to make our routing path more robust. So let's say we have a good set of routing path right now. So how are we actually use them to achieve fast failure recovery? Thing is, like, before that, we have to know how track forwarding actually works in Coronet. So to prevent track forwarding in Coronet, there's two core techniques we use, which is label switching, which is very similar to what MPLS will do. And another one is called flow groups, where we assign same forwarding actions to a group of flows.
All right. This may be hard for you to answer. Well, a picture would be great, but I'm not sure you have it. I'm having a little trouble thinking about how Coronet's fitting in with everything else that's going on. So just calling it an SDN module isn't giving me the kind of picture I'm looking for or the understanding I'm looking for about how it fits with
sure.
other stuff.
So my thesis and dissertation and Kinetic also is tries to handle a lot of dynamics in the network and a lot of network events.
I'm talking about kind of functionally how it fits. Not, I'm not asking about your research contribution. I'm asking about if I have a network that's running Coronet, what else is it running, and how are those things?
Oh,
what kind of relationships are there?
Sure.
And now that you put MPLS in there, I'm like, thanks.
Sure. I actually have a like figure which shows how we do that with how it fits with other SDN components.
Yeah. In the backup slides or something?
No, it's somewhere there.
Oh, it's coming?
Yeah, it's coming. So.
Okay.
I'm not sure whether it's like actually related to your question there, but.
Tell me what you know. Which one is? Oh, it's like this sort of
abstraction stuff.
Pictures?
Yeah.
Jim, do you have an architecture slide that shows?
Yeah.
Yes. We do have that. It's on the backup slides.
That's the word.
So this is the architecture of Coronet.
Okay.
So
well,
this is
exactly
in the control plane. Right, the data plane is hidden right here.
Right.
In the control plane, the Coronet service layer sits here, where the application will be written there. It'll take all the events here and handle them. So the packet is going to go up, and kind of transform it so that it fits virtual topology, which I'll explain later. It takes care of all the flow mods and by itself.
So whenever you talk about Coronet, I think you have to put this picture. I mean, you really help the audience a lot.
Okay. It should not be on the back of this.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'm confused. So I think it's a simple explanation of. So can you explain, you said this is the control plane, of course.
Yeah.
So see that you're running topology, you get updates, push down, the flow mod. But the packet in is data plane. So what causes a packet to come to the control application? Packet in is a data packet in, right?
Yeah.
Yes. So when does a data packet come to the control module? And is it doing anything special
with that
in packet?
So yeah.
I think it's virtualization map. I'm not sure what that's doing. So
in general, in STM, if a packet in comes in and the switch never saw it, it's going to ask the control. And that's how the event comes in, right? To the control plane.
So this is like flow table misses or something?
Yeah, flow table misses. Yeah. So it gets the packet in, and then actually what Coronet does is going to transform that packet fit for the virtual topology. And this is at the entry point. It's not going to do anything in there.
A lot of people have done like optimizations to avoid this like first packet to controller thing with SDN, which isn't so good.
Yeah.
You can proactively push stuff into the switches.
Yes.
Is there a way to do that with Coronet so you don't see the data packet?
Yes, we can pre-populate the flow table so that it doesn't actually ask.
Okay.
We can pre-populate it so that it always has the good bottom policy there. Okay. Alright, so we use flow groups, which assign same forwarding actions to a group of flows. And I'll explain how this works. So in label switching is like the same as MPLS. The label in Coronet denotes a unique routing path. So when a packet tries to communicate with another, with a host tries to communicate with another host, at the ingress switch, we will tag the label, whether it's going to be blue or red. And depending on this label, the routing path and the topology will be determined. So to explain the flow groups, I'll take the ingress switch, which was on that topology. And in the ingress switch, there are two tables. There are a flow table, and there's a group table. And when the flow comes in the ingress switch, the flow table will be populated or pre-populated, to make it better. The action, what we put in the flow table, is not actually the tagging, but we make it refer to a specific group table entry in the group table. And you can see the group tables are actually responsible of tagging the label on the group, which will determine the routing path and topology. So you may ask, like, why are you doing this level one level of indirections just for forwarding? And I will show you why we do this, as I explained before. So let's say the link here goes down and kills the blue tree. If that happens, we have to update the ingress switch. But instead of updating the flow table, we will update the group table. Right. So the action will be now tagged to red, which is a live backup. And this is really interesting. So as you can see, we have recovered and rerouted multiple flows at once with one modification. And you'll see that this technique is really important. And if we apply this to the previous example we had, where we had 12 switches and 256 hosts, turns out that Coronet will only need about 18 updates on the bottom switches and only 3 with the switch with most updates, which is about 54 milliseconds if we extrapolate with the update time we have. That is about 600 times less modifications we can do. We can do better, actually. Let's talk about traffic redistribution. So if there are multiple all-by backups out there, and one failure killed the primary path, but we have red and green, we can distribute traffic to multiple backup paths instead of putting in everything in one backup path. For example, if we have traffic about 100 on the primary path, we can slice it and put 60 red, 40 green. The question is, like, how are we going to come up, and what's the deciding factor of making this ratio? So what we do here is we're going to actually run a linear optimization on the fly if it happens. And we formulate their traffic rerouting problem as a linear optimization problem. So using solving this problem, we compute the best weight distributions to minimize the load on link, which will have the most traffic. And the primary goal is to actually avoid congestion when the failure happens. If you put everything on the backup, it's possible that you're going to just blow up the other link. For this, we use a tool called GNU Linear Programming Kit. And of course, you can use other tools. We use this because it's open source. As in Kinetic, everything is the formulation itself and the computation is all automated. And you can see a theme here that we are using a software to guarantee or optimize stuff. And in this case, we are using a software tool to guarantee the optimized traffic rerouting if a failure happens.
What are the assumptions in the optimization formulation?
Some assumptions.
Like, or maybe I should say this, what are the inputs?
Oh, I see. Okay, the inputs are the current traffic, right?
Meaning what?
Like how much traffic is on the primary route tree, how much traffic is on the links.
So
those
link,
are the current state
link
of the
by link?
Yes.
Link at a time, traffic volume?
Yes.
Okay.
Which we do have information because we the current is the one who's assigning them on the primary trees, and we know what links are using primaries, and we know the loads of the traffic. So the controller can keep track of that. Well, sure. And we have all the routing trees, and we know the group table entries and the pairing between primary and backup. Which backup is going to save what primary, what are the alive backups and what are the dead backups. So using all
the backup
them,
is on a what's the granularity of backing up?
So it's like global protection. So it's in the ingress switch, it's gonna tag a different backup path, and the backup path is just another route tree.
Right, but you know, you showed an example where there was a red tree and a green tree.
Yeah.
So basically there was one essentially on the, I think of that as being essentially on the network level. There was one network which was red and there's one network which was green. And that was to the granularity of backup was the whole network.
So I think as trash, but we don't like switch in between networks. So everything is gonna be side on the edge, right? But that's the granularity. You cannot go
do you back up a path? Half at a time or a network? I mean, that's...
Oh, I see.
And but you know, when you transition, the slide that talks about multiple backup paths is actually also a little bit of my, probably a place where my question first starts to come up. I mean, you're actually talking here not about, I mean, you called it backup paths and primary paths, but it's really a whole tree.
Yeah.
So now I'm wondering whether really there's something you're doing that's more at the path level. Than at the tree level.
Yeah. So maybe I should clarify this better. So we did also try like shorter the path,
mm-hmm.
not just trees. Like,
right.
We have two, we tried two. So we have some,
sorry. I think the question is about the granularity in which you are choosing backups, right? So we have these group table entries, right?
Yeah.
And group table entry, as you presented in the slide, was you just have one group table entry for a whole tree.
Right.
And that's not actually the way it works. It's finer grained than that. So you have actually multiple group table entries to represent a single tree and an ingress switch.
Yeah.
And then in addition to that, so then when that tree fails, then you have to fail over some of those group table entries that are affected, right?
Mm-hmm.
And for each of those group table entries that are affected, you're splitting the traffic that was going to that table entry across multiple backup paths, and you choose the weights at which you distribute the traffic.
That's true, yeah. So, I kind of hide that information, but you see through it, because kind of like very detailed routing stuff. Like, even for group table entries, the output port is actually different. I mean, for the route even, the output ports are different for each host. Right, so we have multiple group table entries.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I'll come in.
Question there.
Sure.
Couple questions on the previous. Like, I'm wondering like about your objective function. It's like minimizing maximum.
Yeah.
Just so several questions.
Okay.
One is why that makes sense in this particular data set environment. So kind of like just as like part of the topology, you know, super congested on a leaf to a service. That seems maybe bad for that service, perhaps less bad than a congestion at the top of my fat tree or something.
I see.
So one is, does this objective function make sense? Well, how does it compare to what other people use, if anything? And then I had just a newbie question about optimization. But it seems to me that minimizing max link is not a linear optimization, right? Like, something would be linear function would be like summing all the link weights, right? And then minimizing the sum as a linear function. But like a max congestion any particular link, obviously it's a linear function, but like if I reduce the congestion on this link, then another link becomes the most congested, right? Mm-hmm. And then now I've got, I guess, is it linear? Like,
it is.
Just
so
like
we
a gradient descent or something?
Yeah, we formulate it as a linear.
Okay, I'd be interested to see the formulation.
Oh,
because
I
I've seen other things that try to do these kind of traffic engineering. They generally do a sum of, you know, weighted sum of link weights or something like that, which clearly is linear. I guess you can make it linear. I just don't.
Yeah,
like
so one of the things is like the objection, actually the objection variable is like this called Z.
Right.
And then we make the Z has to be like, yeah, so it's hard to explain, I guess. I should have actually put in the batch thoughts.
I sort of get it as I talk it out. You have a maximum congestion link, you reduce the congestion on that, and that becomes not the congestion link anymore.
Yeah.
But presumably that value Z just it continues linearly.
Exactly.
Decreases.
Yeah, yeah.
It just jumps to a different link if you then continue.
Yeah, yeah. That's
is that how it works?
Yeah,
okay.
That's how it works.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. That's how it works.
Oh, but you didn't answer my other question.
Oh, sorry.
Why is this a good?
Oh, yeah. So that's a really good question. I think we didn't actually weighted which link or which is more important. And maybe that's important. Like, I think that is actually important. Like, for now, we didn't like weighted anything which link is more important.
Does it matter? I mean, would CoreNet break if you change the objective function? Like, would anything become not scalable or not fast?
I mean, I think it'll not break because you still can put a constraint that has to absolutely like do this, but it can move things around so that it's more optimized for that switch or that switch. And I think that could be applicable to some applications in some networks where you want some traffic to be better treated than others. And like maybe in a like custom, like private company setting, this traffic's paying more. We should give them more, you know, things like that. So.
But I have another question, not about the optimization, but about your failure recovery. So you use the overflow 1.3 group tables for this.
Yes.
What if you, and maybe this, feel free to answer this in a number of different ways. What if you don't have switches that run overflow 1.3 group tables? One response might be, this is a bad question because every switch is going to have group tables someday, is why or something. Another possible answer might be an answer question, about, like directly. What is, I mean, so what's the answer?
I mean, I see.
Good question. So the thing is, like, in our mechanism right now, the edge switches need these group table entries, right? And in the middle, you can use traditional like devices, right? Because in the edge, we're labeling it. And it's important that we use those to recover stuff at the edge, like in the ingress. But in the middle, you don't possibly need all the open flow switches, which may be more friendly for operators.
But if you have, so let's say CoreNet's the only thing the group tables are useful for.
maybe it's not, okay, so this is like a question. then, and earlier you sort of alluded to hardware being kind of in bad shape here as far as support for this stuff.
Yeah.
Could it be possible that like no switches ever like reasonably support OpenFlow 1.3 group tables, and then this is useless, or what do you do? I mean, is there another way around it? Like, can you do it with VLANs, or is there a way around this, or do you absolutely depend on OpenFlow 1.3 group tables?
I don't think we absolutely depend on them.
It's one of the techniques. I mean, if you think about it, OpenFlow is one of the techniques which is the southbound API, like how we do the communication between the switches and the control plane. And if there's a better way of doing, like actually doing this, I mean, if you just follow the high level techniques here and use those, and the other, the underneath, I think it could be flexible, which is, maybe it could be translated to traditional networks too.
It might be useful in the write-up to explain. I mean, you've done a good job in the slides, I think, but I think you're pretty agnostic of OpenFlow here.
Mm-hmm.
But what you've left out is not only the way you did it, but also the way that it could be done in another way. I think for the thesis, that might be pretty useful.
Okay.
But actually, what's to follow up to, what's your opinion on OpenFlow 1.3? Is this something that, I mean, group tables, for example, is this something that you think switches are going to definitely support in some form? Is this a useful enough thing that it's going to be there and you'll be able to take advantage of it? Or is this basically a, you know, some random thing that some OpenFlow guys made up? It's in this thing, and it's in a software switch, but it'll never see the light of day.
Sure. I mean, that depends on a lot of stuff.
Right.
In my personal opinion, I would definitely love to have it. I think it should be there. I mean, using group tables, you can make a lot of interesting choices with fewer modifications. And one of the things that is stopping SCN is actually like you have to make a lot of changes in flow directories, and that's a scalability problem.
Okay.
And group table is one answer to that. And one way or the other, we should have something similar to. It's going to be group table or something similar. I think we should have it definitely.
So it is there in some switches, right? Like the HP switch we use has it, right?
Yeah. There are switches that actually have. So it's actually seeing something like that.
It does have limitations, right? The number of group table entries is somewhat limited, 100 or something like that.
Yeah. So. Yeah, it's still on its baby steps, I would say. They have some limitations of 100 group table entries. So that's one thing.
Are those the kind of things that are, I mean, this 100 number could be very worrisome or not so worrisome for a number of reasons. One is, you might say, well, it's 100, that sucks. But you don't need more than 100. I mean, in a typical data center, maybe do you need more than 100? That might be another.
Yeah.
Do you? I don't know.
Oh, because in Coronet, I actually didn't put it here, but like Coronet, using route trees, you don't need
overloads. That's kind of, The other thing to sort of that I wonder about is it's 100 presumably because of like current constraints of switches, and people are just sort of like trying to shoot more stuff in to what they are already selling.
Yeah.
But what happens in 5 or 10 years? Where you have switches that can support 1,000 or 10,000 group tables, do you think?
I would say it's possible, but we don't really have to push that way. Maybe it's maybe pushing too far that way is actually a bad thing too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like if you have too much freedom and too much, like you tend to, I mean, they tend to like write really bad. And I think one of the things in STN is also because of these constraints in real switches, people come up with really good ways and better ways to do some stuff, like being effective. And like, if you just say like, okay, we'll just endlessly allow so many like data plane like capabilities and switches that like, just like buffer flow.
Mm.
One good example.
It definitely comes at a cost, right?
Yeah.
There's some hardware cost.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
You do that or you do something else, right?
Yeah. And apparently it's not that easy of doing this in hardware switches. Like, it costs a lot.
I see.
Right, the TCAM stuff. So, okay. So I'll go on. So the kernel is our fairly recurring service. We have routing path tree planning. We're doing graph theory, table searching, and grouping, and recovery with optimization. The question is, how do we actually provide this as a service? So before this, I want to explain how it works without Kernet in SDN. And so SDN, you'll have a data plane and a control plane. And the data plane, you'll have the topology and those attached. In the control plane, you'll have the controller runtime and operators will make their own SDN application. To simplify just very simply how it works, if a packet in it comes in and the switch notifies the control runtime, just passes back to the application. The operator has to write some code so that it actually handles this, and it'll push routing decision back, and the runtime will then make some flow table entry updates on the data. If a link goes down like this, the control runtime will catch that failure event, send it up to the application. Normally, operators have to write some extra code for this and fix the field entries, and the runtime will then honor that. This is how it works. So where Kernet fits is between the application and the runtime. So the first thing Kernet does is to actually make a virtual topology abstraction of the whole physical topology and send that up to the application. So the application view of the network looks like this one-way switch with host attached. And when the packet ending in event comes in, the Kernet service will snatch that, transform it, and send a virtual packet in event, which is fit for the topology. The operator can just write some forwarding behaviors based on this virtual topology. We'll push it to Kernet, and Kernet will translate that for the real topology and send it to runtime. The runtime will make the changes accordingly. So if a failure happens like this, the control runtime will get that and pass it on as normal, but Kernet will snatch that, takes care of it by itself. We do some recovery on the real network by itself, and the SDN application does not need to know anything about that if that actually happened. So the operator is now free from making extra code for that. So we evaluated Kernet on emulated real networks. The networks are emulated using the tool called MiniNet, and we have varying number of switches and varying number of links. The B41 is the Google WAN network, AT&T's AT&T backbone. Jellyfish and Clone networks are some canonical data center network topologies. We used a real-
How did you pronounce that word, C-L-O-S?
I guess it's CLO. Is that right, Shusha? That's CLO. So you have to pronounce it CLO.
I'm not actually sure how it's pronounced.
I think everyone I heard is so.
In the Midwest, you'd probably just say Kloss, right?
Exactly.
Let's say Kloss network. All right.
Yeah,
so
exactly. That's the advantage of the Midwest. You don't have to mess around with any crazy accents. You just say every letter the way it is.
So we use real traffic traces, which are from the designated Microsoft Data Center. Thank them for providing this. And we evaluate Kernet in terms of recovery time when a failure happens, and the link load distribution after failure to see the benefit of running the optimization. So here you can see on the y-axis the recovery time, and oh, there's an echo going on. And then the right side, the x-axis will show the total recovery time for different topologies. And so the recovery time is going to be the combination of switch update time and LP computation time. So the LP computation time is the time it takes to optimize things in the controller. The switch update time is actually extrapolated using the number of updates it needs and the rule update time we had, which is switch collapse.
I can turn off my
speaker. Unless you want to say
it. Sure. Okay. I muted it.
So so that's it. The switch up time is just trapped that way. And the recovery time is the summation of these two. The solid bar is showing when we use routing paths as route trees, meaning the spanner trees. We also did some experiment when we use k shortest path. So it's k because we're going to have backups too for each host pairs. So if we do this, it shows it definitely the recovery time kind of increases as there are more switches and links. Jellyfish takes kind of more time because we have this switch which has a lot of connections. So that's why it had a lot of updates. So Jellyfish interestingly had more recovery time. But it shows that even for these large networks, the recovery time stays a little below 1.5 seconds. Next is the link load distribution after failure.
So the LP computation time,
yeah.
Is it possible that you could pre-compute those as well? I mean, for example, you know
yeah.
possible failures, you could presumably pre-compute some
yeah. So
depending on how you assume the stability of the traffic matrix.
Exactly. So that's one thing. So we try to do a lot of pre-computation in advance before the failure because we kind of know what's going to happen. But some has to be done because there's the notion of current traffic on the traffic. And I mean, if we assume there's some stability, we can do it advanced too. Like maybe do it like periodically, do it like before the failure with the current traffic you have. Then we can actually shorten it a lot.
Interesting problem. So like, can you pre-compute some and then do an incremental?
Yeah, that's yeah.
Is that what you do?
I mean, no. Like we don't do that. But like a lot of time goes into actually defining some variables for the linear optimization problem too. Solving itself actually doesn't take that much sometimes, but like a lot of stuff goes into defining stuff and defining the traffic load based on the traffic load and stuff. Maybe that's interesting because there are some techniques and research doing incremental update. Right. And I think maybe we can leverage some good works. Just try to do that. But currently we don't. Like we try to optimize a lot of stuff, but right now we just take the current traffic right now and we compute. But if we use some more good techniques, I'm sure it can go down. Right. Especially if the traffic is stable. All right. So the next slide shows the link load distribution after failure. So this graph is somewhat hard to understand, so I'll explain it better. So it's a CDF, first of all, and then when the x-axis is showing the max link load compared to equal weights. So what is the equal weights? It means like if you have multiple backups, instead of doing some smart stuff, you're just gonna equally distribute traffic on the multiple backups. So it's something very similar to what ECMP would do, right? So you have multiple backups, just split it equally among. So we're just assuming if you do some linear optimization, of course, we're going to do slightly better on link load. So this shows, we did it with varying topologies. For the AT&T, you can interpret it as this. 80% of failure events, max utilization is 60% or less compared to equal weights. For CLO network or POST network, 50% of failure events. Max size is 90% or more compared to equal weights. So it kind of varies between topologies and specific how it's wired and what. So it definitely shows linear optimization is having some benefits on topology and max link load. To summarize CoreNet, we designed an SDN module service to handle unplanned network events, which are data plane failures. We provided fast recovery even with large networks, and our service works together with arbitrary SDN applications, and we do that by giving a constrained virtual topology to the applications. Some publication out of this, we had a poster in ICMP 2012. We have a full paper ready, actually, just for submission, and we are planning to submit to the next article. So I want to conclude my thesis talk with some of your contributions and future work. So for the summary of contribution, we did the first extensive longitudinal analysis study on network configuration changes, which was actually my proposal. I didn't present it this time. We designed and implemented two systems, which provide better ways of handling various types of network events. We also explored ways and explore ways to bring verifications and guarantees into our using software tools. Some lessons learned I want to give to Philip students who want to do this, something similar to this. I would say I learned that upper bit level occurring constraints are better than none. If you give too much freedom to operators or developers, they lose their way. And without guidance, they tend to make really buggy programs out there. And that's bad. So some good abstraction and constraints are better than just not giving all the freedom to them. So another thing is like, okay, you can have a great abstraction, but if that fails and you have a bug, sometimes it's hard to debug because it's hiding a lot of stuff. So as we discussed, I think in the middle, like it's really important that you have good balance and also have good tools to debug stuff. In Kinetic, we try to prevent having any bugs by having a model checker, but even some bugs can slip through that, and it's really important to prevent that from happening. And I will give a big yes to researchers in software engineering, theoretical computer science, and languages and math. I mean, I think I personally, for my thesis works, I really try to leverage a lot of research, great research done in these fields. I think that should happen more in networking. And we should try to really use these to apply to networking and to verify stuff and guarantee stuff and all that stuff. So for future work, there are some future about verifying program correctness. We use CTL as our example, but there are also all other languages called FTL, which can describe other temporal properties about state machines, and we had some feedback about better reusability because sometimes these languages are harder to understand and write. So we have some thoughts on how to make that easier for them. There are some thoughts about combining with correctness and other stacks. So Kinetic will confirm and verify that the program is correct, but there should be also consistent updates to the data plane, right? So if you don't have consistent updates, some part of the network would have some other state, while the other have a different state. So there are some good work on, especially from Professor Nate Foster, which talks about consistent updates on data plane. Because Kinetic makes so many changes itself, it's really important that we combine these two together. Also, some feedback I got from the operators in Nanog was like, we need correctness and guarantees that the data plane has the correct state. So even if we say the program pushes the right stuff, we need some guarantees that data plane does have that, actually follows that update, which is, I think, is also really important for them if you apply that for collision networks. So I'm looking into how we do that. There are some good work on which verifies the data plane, but I didn't see anything which tries to match that with the program people have, operators have. Some other works, future works for data plane resilience is, right now we only have this one big switch abstraction for the virtual topology, but maybe operators want more view of the actual physical network, right? Maybe they want more than just one switch. They want to define their own virtual network and they want to write their own application based on their own virtual network. So there are some future work on that. Right now, we only support kind of one SDN application, but what if you have a whole data center and you want to make customers write multiple SDN applications and run it simultaneously? How are we going to support that? It's also some good feature we can work on. So I had some other research efforts along my PhD studies. Yeah, UCAP. I did some work on other works like PKMBN.NET or Coursera was another language we worked on with Andy from Yale. And I want to personally thank Dr. Lee Keemster for guiding me through my PhD studies, and Dr. Ellen Zabura, Dr. Mustafa Amar, Dr. Yusha Turner, and Dr. Nate Foster for being my committee members and guiding me through and making me write a better thesis. And I want to thank all the other friends I had, NCG, and all the people, great people I had in Joint Tech, and you made me survive this. So, give a big thank you, and for now, I'll take any questions.
So maybe we should see if anyone else has questions
sure.
too, and then also we should make sure Yoshi has.
Yeah,
Yoshi has. Yeah.
So any questions from the gallery or students?
Just curious, you were mentioning the compilation time in the Pyrotech, in Kinetic is like 200 milliseconds. So what's the baseline you're considering? Is it like the baseline of how the events arrive?
I see. So what's the baseline? So the question is like, when we did the evaluation kinetic compilation time and event handling, it's 200 ms. What's the baseline for that? That's the question. That's a really good question. We should have, like, maybe compared with other platforms how they are doing. We actually didn't find any related work which tries to do this. So this is our first.
You're trying to minimize this, right?
We try to minimize this.
So
just
I'm just curious, how low would you like to go? Like how much?
I see.
How much low is a good number? Like is it order of?
I mean, okay, that's a good question. So one of the things I read on the literature is like, I saw something like 50 ms is the thing that people feel. They can like detect like if it's upper than 50 ms, they feel it. Like for real ongoing traffic like VoIP or something, if it's over 50 ms, they feel it. So it'd be ideal if you can go below 50 ms. I would say.
Okay. So is this a limitation of Pyrotech you're using as a day like?
Yeah, I mean so we actually did a lot of optimization on the policy compliance on Pyrotech. Actually, because our study went on, we did a lot of optimization. I think we can do better actually on that sense. So that's one important thing. I mean, it's because we're using Pyrotech, but I think we can do better doing some optimization on the runtime. But one thing to see is like this is not happening all the time. This happens when the event comes in and changes the forwarding behavior. So also one way would to program stuff so that you'd have to like recompile it every 1 second or so.
So just on similar lines, like so Pyrotech I guess is for researchers mostly, or is it in the production environment also like Facebook or some other company, or is there some other software stack these people?
So yeah, there are a lot of controllers out there. I think many people use this thing called Floodlight. HV band controller is also one thing out there. There's Open Daylight, which is I think a lot of people are contributing. But all these like production networks, they have a lot of people working on it, and the abstraction is not actually that good. It's getting more complicated, I think, and giving too much freedom sometimes is making more buggy problems there too. But there are a lot of good controllers out there.
If I understand correctly, the CoreNet assumes that multiple virtual pods are available in the network to work correctly. Is that something that your Kinetic piece of work can actually connect? Are you able to write a program that Kinetic will validate for you?
I see. So I'm trying to like actually understand the question better. So like,
I think you can you check for the existence of multiple paths,
yeah.
Backup paths.
Oh, I see. Oh, okay. So can you check the?
You assume that there are, you know, your work is basically the starting point is that there are backup paths.
Yeah.
So
CoreNet's the goal is to actually hide all those informations from the upper, and Kinetic, I think it doesn't. Kinetic does not like verify individual path. It's more like. Is it going to push the right updates to the, and so it doesn't like verify, doesn't take into account the multiple path. But I think it could be interesting. I think it's some interesting work we can work on. But my initial like thought is like we should just hide all those informations from the operator. Like why do we have to know the backup path, because they don't even do anything along the backup path. They probably just want to make sure the backup path will give the same properties that kind of path. That's all they want.
But somebody has to, but the, so, I mean, someone has to establish the backup? I mean, I think we're, you know, where's the step which is to plan the primary and backup paths? Who's doing that?
So Corona is doing that using the graph theory. So
okay.
It kind of guarantees
so
it. So that's Kinetic is not using
the
guarantee.
And so when it does that using the graph theory, it could return false or something, right? It could
Now I understand. So the using the graph theory, we can say like, okay, this is not possible. This will not survive.
So we give
guarantees.
If you're in data center networks where there's a lot of regularity, it's probably not. You expect there to be backup paths in part because the networks are designed with such regularity. They have them because that's a feature of the structure.
Yeah.
I guess maybe Jellyfish might, something that has randomization. At least then there is something to discover. in some sense, where the others are just built that way.
Is the algorithm that you're using to identify these joint paths like a polynomial in time? Problem and you have to do some approximation?
No, we don't do any approximation. It is bounded. It's based on what kind of like, so there are actually really good work on graph theory, which analyzes the complexity of coming with these backup paths. And I would say it's definitely not linear. There's some, but it's not like heuristic. So there's no. There are some work which tries to lower that bound by doing some heuristics too. But the thing we do is bounded.
So the Kinetic, you can write smaller programs typically. How hard is it to write that? Because that was not part of the consideration. Or what you were asking, is that why you asked the people the survey questions? Which do you prefer? Where that comes in? Because shorter isn't necessarily better.
Yeah. Shorter doesn't mean it's better. Mm-hmm. I guess harder, right? Mm-hmm. So the question is like, is Kinetic good for like writing small programs?
Sure.
Is it
easy to write a shorter program than it is with something else?
I would say okay. If Kinetic has some, it's constrained, but it has a lot of structure to it, and it has some like places where it requires some things, and because of that, you don't have to put it sometimes, but you have all the structure already pre-built. And because of that, if you're actually writing a really simple program, which doesn't change behavior based on other events, it could be probably overkill, I would say. Right? Like if you're writing simple programs, just use PyWriting or Box, which is perfect for that. But if you're writing programs which will change based on other events, Kinetic is better.
Much quicker, easier to understand.
Yeah, easier to understand, and you can verify. Right? The Kinetic verifies. Well, it's going to change correctly and push things correctly. And if it's not changing, there's no point of using
it. So in Coronet, you basically assume that like case suppressing failures is a good option. But like, I assume like, okay, for switch networks, for forwarding, it might be a good option. But do you think like as a general policy, it is good in networks to suppress failures, like removing all the flexibility from operator?
Yeah. So that's why one of the features I talked was you actually some operators don't want to have all that masks from them,
right?
So that's one of the concerns. Yes, I agree. So that's why there are some thoughts on future work so that we can actually let them decide their own virtual topology. So that we give that flexibility so that they want to do some traffic engineering. By themselves,
right.
Instead of doing just one big switch. So,
right.
yeah, I agree. Like just blindly hiding everything is not a good way.
And also, like I think it will open them to if you want to handle failures on the function layer, like on the middle boxes layer.
Yeah.
It will be easier for them. For example, if IDS1 fails, switch back to IDS2. But if they don't know the failure, they will be offline.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yeah, definitely. If they want to do that, we should give some topology which they can actually see this, right? So if you give some more detail, which topology they can write their own based on that.
So maybe we want to let the audience go and then we bring.
I'll ask one more.
Sure.
So, in light of like maybe your next job, you'll encounter some operators.
Yeah.
Shares, walks.
Yeah.
And skepticism, and skill sets.
Yeah.
Like so, what would you say? You're describing your work here. What would you say? What would you say to someone who said, yeah, that's all very nice, but Hieretic, it's this research thing. Kamenev said, it's not a real controller.
Yeah.
And these switches, maybe not. Yeah, it's no good. And by the way, I don't know how to program. So, which is kind of common. So one question is like, what would you want someone like that to take away from your work? Assuming you couldn't convince them that they were wrong on any of those points, could you say, yes, okay, but still, here's what I want you to learn?
Yeah, sure.
The first question I would ask him, like try to convince him again, is like, okay, are your life miserable? And he would mostly say yes, I would say. And if he denies it, I will not help him. But anyway.
But I would say, like, yes, I'm like Cisco certified.
Cisco certified.
You know,
yeah.
I love.
So actually, I got
Cisco
a.
Cisco config.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know
so.
Python or your thing.
Yo, so I actually got the similar question when I was in there. Actually. So this operator had the
okay.
same question.
Okay. Yeah.
What I answered was like, okay, SDN is a good approach. And some private controllers are doing a good approach here. But I actually personally think like we also can find a hybrid way of doing this. Right? I mean, we're not saying like we're going to transfer all the network to use SDN. And everyone needs to know like how to control programs, how to program these control programs. And we don't have to like replace all the switches, all the infrastructure which is already built in there. And that's not Pacto anyway. Like the switches are SDN switches are not ready. Some controller features we still need them. But I would say like that doesn't mean we should not try. Right? We should try better and we should try to bring correctness and verification to the network, which there's none like that. Mm-hmm. And we can do the like update and improvement of that. Like we don't have to do that at once. Like, it could be incremental. And I would try to say like, okay, I'm not gonna force you to program all the stuff and force you to learn new skill sets. I wanna still use you'll have your own good techniques and knowledge, but we'll work together, right? Like I'll work on that part, give me feedback on that, we can do some hybrid stuff. So that would be the way I would try to convince him and say like, see, I have some good features here. Try to like improve the network.
So thanks.
Now I'm ready. Please.
So, okay.